Tonight on Nights of Horror, we return with Matt Ryan Tobin.
My eyes. I'm scared to open them.
You then worked with, this is another Mondo piece. But as you said, your poster was for Hero Complex, which was Blair Witch. And the poster and the LP gatefold are very, very different.
You went
in radically different directions.
Well, the soundtracks for the sequel, right? For the movie that came out, three or four years ago, I think. So, I mean, the films are radically different, you know? I think essentially the job was taken on because I had done Blair Witch before, and I love the Blair Witch Project. I love that film. I don't care who knows it. I think it's fantastic. It still resonates with me when I watch it. Like, I still just like, I gotta like run up the stairs really fast after I watch that film. You know what I mean? Like, when you're going to bed, like, films still do that to me, which I'm happy to say that films can still scare me that much. But,
I saw it in theaters and I got motion sickness because you didn't have like the whole cinema verite found footage film.
See, I watched it. First time I saw it was on VHS in my basement. So it felt probably more real than it would in a theater, I feel.
Yeah.
Like, because it's like, oh, it's like I found this somewhere, this tape. Yeah. And, you know, and that's what I got from it. Where I can imagine seeing it in a theater also just like be very, you know, creating vertigo, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but, I mean it just wasn't a thing that cinema did at that time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But yeah, with that with the soundtrack, I was just trying to keep the minimalist aspect that I had in the poster and apply it, but just make it feel darker and a little bit newer, but just really subtle. I wanted it to be like you were in the dark when you're looking at it. Things are hard to see, they're hard to adjust your eyes to, and you know, that kind of thing.
Okay. Then for Mondo, you did Nightmare on Elm Street.
Mm-hmm.
This is our guy here hugging everybody, hugging it out on Elm Street.
Yeah. That was a request on my part. I think that was after Jaws, actually. I had said to Rob, I'm like, hey Rob, do you think I'd ever have the chance to do Nightmare on Elm Street? You know, it's getting a little bit, maybe asking too soon, you know, but he was like, well, send, you got a concept? I was like, yeah. He goes, send it. So I sent it and he goes, yep. And I was like, awesome. So I got to execute that one as well. That was for, I think Texas Frightmare. We did that as an exclusive release for Texas Frightmare weekend. But yeah,
your inspiration was the alleyway scene, I'm guessing.
The alleyway scene. Yeah. Which is still effective. I love that effect, even though it's, you know, like PVC piping on string, you know what I mean? but again it was an aspect that I had never seen sort of tackled before, and I was like, oh, I can exaggerate this, I can get really dreamlike with it. Looking back on it now, I wish I had kind of like, I didn't do the composition just straight on. I wish I created some more angular depth of field with it and made it really exaggerate, which is something that I would have done now, but you know, but it's still a concept that I really liked. It was, his arms are weaving in and out of the bedrooms like dreams, you know, and he's everywhere. It's his world, you know what I mean?
Well, also follows the chase sequence at the end.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
With him and Nancy.
Yeah.
I mean, it's definitely a very different piece than what you normally see with other, I mean, another very tapped in to property.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Why were you so interested in doing that one?
Nightmare on Elm Street, since I was a kid, is one of my favorite horror movies. That was one of like the ones that I fell in love with really young. And I think a lot of people did with horror, with Freddy Krueger. You know, he was like an icon, essentially. I mean, I didn't see Nightmare on Elm Street. Actually, the first one I had ever saw was Part 2. And I love Part 2. I think it's a great film.
We will get into that one.
But I love Part 2. And then I actually saw Freddy's Dead, I think. And it's then like I saw...
Six, I think.
Yeah, six. And then I saw New Nightmare. And then I saw Dream Warriors. And then I saw the original. Like, it was this, you know, like this, right? There was no pattern to it. But when you're a kid, you just got what was available at the Blockbuster or Jumbo Video or whatever. And sometimes they didn't have the entire series, you know.
Dream Warriors is my favorite act. I like the third of stuff, apparently.
Oh, dude, no, Dream Warriors is my favorite. The first, I love Dream Warriors the most. But the first one is just, it has a tone that none of the other films have. So that's why I tackled that property. Also with hopes of doing maybe some sort of, you know, companion piece for Part 3 later. You know,
that's, well, you clearly need to do the soundtrack, right?
Well, the soundtrack's already been done, actually.
Yeah, but you need to do the soundtrack.
No, man, Mike Saputo killed it. He did that whole box set, and it's, nobody could have done it better. He nailed it. You know, that one's done.
So you have pieces like that. You're just like, nah.
Like what? Sorry.
Like that box set for Nightmare on Elm Street. You have like pieces. You're just like, it's been done.
There are some things. I mean, it's like, sometimes you want to work on a film just because you love it so much, you know, and you want to put something out in the world that didn't exist the day before. But also, like, there are times where I've been like, you know what? Like, I don't know if it's worth it for me to do it, you know, unless a good idea comes along. And it's not necessarily a good idea of, like, I think it's better than, you know, said person's work. But it's just, like, it's something that adds to the legacy of the art that surrounds whatever film it is, you know. If it doesn't add anything, then I don't see the point, you know, in really doing it. So
then you return to Hero Complex for at least two more pieces. You had Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was fun. That was a fun one. It took forever, that nobody liked. Yeah, the idea was, I guess, a sort of morbid, like, theme park map of Texas, where it was sort of all quilted together, you know, in Leatherface fashion, you know. And I thought, I still like the poster, honestly, to this day. I still like it a lot. I even like the palette of it. And we did it on like this special paper, the regular edition. Actually, they're both on special paper. The regular edition's on like this, it's like a cream paper, but it has like these weird greasy swatches. So when you pick it up, it's like, it looks like it's got like food grease on it. It's really interesting. It's kind of shiny in parts and brown. Okay. And then on the variant, we did an actual, like, a craft paper that you would wrap meat in, like, you know, when you go to like a meat shop or whatever. So I still love those pieces, but yeah, that one's kind of like, that's pretty on the nose as far as an idea you could do for Texas Chainsaw Massacre. You know, it's the shape of Texas. It's got all the things you like from a movie in it, you know, but sometimes you also just need to execute an idea just to get it out of your brain, I think, too. You know,
stuff lives there too long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then you did a really interesting Fright Night poster, which is incredibly different than anything you think about with Fright Night necessarily. I mean, you do have like the iconic house in the background, but you know, you have the hand with the apple.
Well, I just love the idea that is it Chris Sarandon was just like, I had read or heard or watched that he was the one who suggested that Jerry Dandridge just be constantly eating fruit. And I know there's a reason behind it. I can't remember what it is now, but he's like, he should just always be eating fruit, like, like slurping on a piece of fruit, you know what I mean? Whereas like usually in most vampire lore, like they literally can't eat anything except for blood.
Do you watch What We Do in the Shadows, the TV series?
No, I started watching it and I just fell off. Not because it wasn't fantastic, but I'll get back to it eventually, you know.
It's like there's a scene when one of the vampires, the Baron, eats a piece of pizza. And he projectile vomit flies into the air because he's eating human food.
Yeah.
Sire, this is an even worse idea than when we tried to invade Vienna.
I am having pizza pie.
The garlic burnt a little, but...
Down he goes.
Up again.
The Baron has eaten some human food and now his body is being propelled around by his own vomit.
Is he all right?
Where's he gone?
So that's what's happening right now.
There he is.
Ooh.
Well, I would think he'd die because the amount of garlic that's usually in pizza.
Yeah.
You know? Did I find a plot hole? Did I find a hole?
They don't adhere to it. Very strange.
Yeah. No, but with that poster, I was just like, the fruit thing. Fruit thing sticks out. It's weird, the fruit thing. And then the idea that, like, it is kind of symbolic of, symbolic, not a word. It is kind of symbolistic.
Symbolic?
Symbolic, thank you so much. Edit all that out. Symbolic of like Charlie's world, essentially. Like he's got Charlie by the, you know, the gonads. He's got everything's right here in his hand. He's slowly consuming everything about his world, and his house is just sitting right there and is about to be the next bite, you know what I mean? And I like that aspect and showing the extra long fingers, which are, you know, sort of sexualized in a way. Again, his character Jerry Danger is very sexual in the film and has a lot of those tones to the film. And so yeah, the original one sheet is so fantastic, even though it really doesn't pertain at all to the film, you know, with the house with the ghost vampire face over top of the house.
But it's the girlfriend at the end when she turns.
Yeah, and it's a beautiful photo, but I just was like, I feel like I just wanted to do something different. Not that I ever compare anything to the one sheet. I don't even know why I made that comparison, but I don't know, man. I think I've said it like 30 times. I just wanted to do something different.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's fine.
Trying to find a new angle. Yeah, just trying to find a new angle. That's all.
I mean, it's also a great foreshortening example, you know, in terms of like technique, because you basically have zero middle ground in the piece. Because it's so dominant. So it's interesting, because usually what happens with that is you see this like block prints, right? It compresses everything when you don't have a middle ground,
right?
But because you've got the a round object in the apple and the fingers are like curling around it, you add a force perspective in there that creates the depth in this illusory way. another fun word to say.
We're having a word time today.
Yeah, it's even more fun when you're wearing one of the masks and you're teaching and you're trying to say words like that. Yeah, the mask goes in your mouth.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it's an interesting just in terms of like technique piece as well. Okay.
sorry, I thought you were in the No,
that was my point.
Oh, no. Well, thank you. Yeah. I mean, I think the reason why I didn't have, because I don't think the fingers don't actually wrap around the apple, right? It's more, they're more straight out.
Yeah. They're like sort of, but they're holding it. I mean,
they're holding it. But I think it was the sort of like gentle, it was like that's the posture of the fingers is there. It's like, it's actually like that for two reasons. One, because I wanted it to feel like gentle, like alluring, like, you know, but also if you look at Jerry, when his fingers do that, they actually added these extension prosthetics on his fingers, and they didn't bend. They had no like set of knuckles, so it was like this, right? So his hands are also just kind of stuck like that. Do you know what I mean?
It's very Nosferatu.
Yes. Yeah.
The next piece is The Gate, I think. Your next horror piece. I guess I'll put that in the cult category again.
Yeah. It should be more universally known. I mean, for the amount of people that rant and rave about Goonies and Monster Squad, you know, it's like the fact that enough people haven't seen The Gate is a disservice. So I think it's fantastic. I think it's a great movie.
It is interesting because when I was a kid, I was obsessed with Monster Squad, as I think most people mm-hmm. who are, you know, in their 30s now and still into horror probably were. And I watched it again recently for the first time in like 20 years. And I was like, huh, you really can't go back home, can you?
Yeah.
We're fond of horror blasphemies here.
Yeah.
So we throw out controversial things like that. I mean, yeah. I've said that Halloween 3 is my favorite Halloween movie so many times that.
Yeah. And people are just at your door with torches, just like,
yeah, really, Well, we were doing this whole Halloween show, and one of the scholars said she actually preferred Rob Zombie's Halloween. So I felt a lot safer in my opinion.
Oh, there you go. Then you're fine. You're just, yeah. I'm going to slip out of here while everyone's distracted right now.
Yeah, I was like, wow, okay.
Yeah.
That was a controversial moment.
To be honest, and it's probably a hot take, but I actually really enjoyed his sequel. I like the sequel.
Rob Zombie's.
Rob Zombie sequel. And I actually saw a director's cut that edited out the whole horse mom ghost story. And I thought it was actually a really good film, standalone. It's not, again, comparing it to Halloween is like a moot point. You know what I mean? There's no sense in comparing it to the original or anything like that.
Well, I mean, look, what if you watch the whole, I mean, let's take 3 out and say that 3 is its own film. And if you just watch the Michael Myers films, right, there is a lot to snark at in the entire, I mean, Halloween H2O, I mean, the whole movie is just terrible. So, yeah. The guy who makes a brief appearance in the first one that Loomis is screaming at he's illegally parked ends up being a cult leader who performs demonic rituals on Michael, I think in part 6.
Yeah.
So there's plenty here to be questioning.
Yeah.
To go around.
Yeah, so. And if it's one or the other, really, I don't think you have a strong argument for any of the sequels. So.
Yeah, I mean, you know, because it's interesting. Like, you know, Friday the 13th, some of the sequels are pretty good. Mm-hmm. I mean, some are horrible, but some are pretty good. Some have their moments, particularly sort of like Zombie Jason.
Yeah. Everybody likes Jason Lives.
Tommy Jarvis is an interesting character. Not just because we share the same last name, but you know, I don't just have guests because we share the same first name either.
Yeah,
but
I was noticing. I was like, wait, all these guests have the same. No,
right? Yes, just you and Matt Ruff. But yeah, so it is interesting that way. Then, I mean, you tackle another major property for Mondo. You did American Werewolf in London.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That one, that's one of my favorite pieces I think I've ever done, my favorite posters I've ever done. And that really leans into, I think, that was a big transitional point for me in my style, I think. That's when I said really led, what am I trying to say here? That's when I led hard into, I don't know, that's when, that was a turning point. We'll just say it's a turning point stylistically. Lots of use of like deep shadows and high saturated contrasting light and things like that. And I sort of, I found my pocket, I think, with that poster. And I still love how that one turned out. That was essentially, you know, I was trying to show the werewolf without showing the werewolf too much and just try to come from a different perspective again, like usual.
See, I disagree on this one. This one's your most logical poster to me.
You think so?
I do. Well, because everybody shows the slaughtered lamb.
Yeah.
And you didn't do that. You went to the rooftops.
No, I didn't have like, I don't know, the moon be the eye of the wolf, or, you know, there's a million, you know, I guess you could call them tropes, you know, approaches to it. Originally, the poster concept was supposed to be more like it's Piccadilly Circus, right? And mm-hmm. then it's got that fountain that's central Piccadilly, and I wanted the werewolf to actually be more, feel more like he was etched, or not etched into, but he was the fountain. Like, he was molded from it. So you really didn't even see the werewolf at all. Like, he wasn't even there unless you really looked. And he was actually much smaller. And it just, again, sometimes the idea that you have in your head just doesn't translate the way you want to when you lay it down. And so you go, you know what? He's still not super visible. It's not like, oh, werewolf. You know, there's more going on around it that brings your eye into the center, you know? But yeah, it's definitely not conceptual in terms of, like, if you compare it to, I don't know, Black Swan or Fright Night, but I still think that it's not as straightforward as it could have been, you know?
Okay. I think it's more straightforward than a lot of you're more like, I think you usually go towards more concept. I feel like, I don't know, for me at least, mm-hmm. because I think everybody else goes to iconography when they mm-hmm. do American Werewolf, and they you don't get much wolf, you know, it's sort of mm-hmm. like Jaws without Jaws, mm-hmm. Or without the shark fin, which is what you now mm-hmm. more commonly see, to pick on DeRue again, mm-hmm. but I don't know, for me that one at least is the one that was most sort of like logical to the film, but nobody had gone there yet.
Right No, that makes sense. I don't, I mean, sometimes I can get too caught up in you know, the subliminary meaning or whatever that I'm trying to put into a piece. And sometimes some films just work a little bit more direct. And I think that was one of them. It's like, I probably couldn't also, if that was the first, that was most likely the first idea that ever came to me. So, you know, it was probably just didn't feel like it was something that I needed to go extremely conceptual or abstract with the composition, you know. But I think just in terms of, you know, how it looks and then all the work that followed that feels, that was just an important poster to have done, just for that reason, if that reason only.
So then we have, sticking with Mondo and Death Waltz, you have a gatefold that is very conceptual, mm-hmm. and that you did the Devil's Candy.
Oh yeah. Yeah,
gatefold, which I have to imagine this was rather near and dear.
Why would you assume that?
Well, just the way you designed it.
Well, it was like, again, I'll let you in on a little thing. I hate drawing people. Okay. I hate drawing faces.
Oh, jeez.
And actors. Only, even if it's only because all of the snags you run into with approvals sometimes, you know, like, it's just like, even like, if you can go back and look at my Let the Right One In poster, like Ellie's, she's her face crops out of the poster, I think just above her nose. Because also there's something about showing her eyes that I felt was too direct. It was too like, it takes you out of what the concept is if you're focused on somebody's face, right? And so with Devil's Candy, for example, I was like, oh, I came up with an idea that's completely devoid of showing anybody. Do you know what I mean? And looking like a metal album, like a Whitesnake album cover, you know? And the idea was to have the flying V is essentially devil horns. That is
the pentagram.
Well, it's devil horns, actually. Okay. That was the idea.
Okay.
But it can be read as the peak point of the pentagram or whatever, but I wanted it to feel, you know, like devil horns, essentially. But I just wanted it to have that 80s 99 cent bin album feel to it, you know, and the wear and tear of it all, and again, very 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 less is more type of approach.
Well, it's interesting too, because I mean, the film of course is about making art,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And then just sort of like making very disturbing art.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So it brings with it, I think, issues that, you know, you either have to deal with or not.
Oh, you mean in terms of like, do I really sort of hone in on that aspect of it and focus on the art aspect or completely ignore it altogether?
Yeah, I mean, you kind of have to make that decision early, I feel like.
Yeah, well, that was a hard ignore.
Yeah, I got that.
yeah. No, I just, again, I wanted something minimalist. And I think too, with that job, I think it was a quick turnaround too. Like, it had to be done relatively fast. So we kept it very simple and, you know, and to the point. But again, that was one of those ideas where, again, I've only seen the film once. I watched it once. I think it was great. I just haven't really gone back.
Yeah, that's a good film. I don't know that it needs.
Yeah, exactly. So, so even when you're like, oh, he's a painter, I'm like, completely forgot. And then I was like, oh yeah, he's in the barn with the thing, listening to the death metal, like the black metal and everything. And but
actually, I mean, I would have thought you would have latched onto as an artist was not actually him, but dealing with the galleries.
Oh, right. Yeah. No, man, I didn't even.
Because it was an artist story, and I was just like, yeah.
Yeah. See, I never had that type of issue with a gallery ever. So it was, there was no relation, I don't think.
Have you seen Velvet Buzzsaw?
That's the one. Okay. I think I have seen. Did I stop?
Jake Gyllenhaal?
It? Yes. No, I did see it. Rene Russo, right? Yeah. Is in it. Someone stick their arm in the big sphere and takes their arm off. Man, I did see that, but I don't remember anything about it.
I have similar feelings watching Velvet Buzzsaw as I did mm-hmm. Devil's Candy.
Yeah.
Because I mean, I just got so hung up on like the gallerists in it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, they're supposed to be insufferable. And maybe that took me out of the movie because, you know, I don't know what it was. But I don't remember any of it. But I definitely have seen that film.
See, I went to grad school in California and I just went to all of these kind of openings. And I was like, oh, God, I'm having flashbacks.
Yeah. God, I can't even imagine. If I'd gone, I always wanted to go to art school, but I didn't because I told you I went on tour and everything. But but yeah, I've met enough people like that in my life. You know,
I always tell students it's the strokey beard. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I tend to do the strokey mustache thing from time to time, but that's usually because I can't, because I'm just fidgeting.
I always encourage the female students to do it.
But you have to, yes. It has to be like the phantom beard.
Yeah, yeah, very long, wise Gandalf kind of.
Yeah.
Another film that I feel like is missing here is it's a complete flip on this. It would be Deathgasm.
I
feel like that's somewhere in your future.
I did a shirt for Deathgasm.
Did you? Okay.
Yeah, I designed a shirt for them, for a company called Fright Rags.
Mm-hmm.
Good friends of mine. I did a shirt for Deathgasm. That's about that. That's about it.
Did it have an enormous dildo on it?
I don't know. Yeah, I know it didn't have a dildo. It had that. I think it, there probably maybe it did. Did it?
Maybe it did. Did I use a dildo?
I made a shirt, a metal band shirt, but it wasn't very like Norwegian black metal authentic. It was more like metalcore, like a, I don't know, like a an All That Remains type of T-shirt design. It wasn't very specific to Norwegian black metal, but I think and there might have been the dildo on it because it's got a bunch of stuff. It's got like saw blades and all the stuff making a pentagram out of sheets of metal. And
okay,
God, I feel like there might be a wiener on it though.
See, you didn't expect this remember. Today. You did not expect to be discussing dildos today.
No, especially not designs I did like 10 years ago. Well, I don't have any recollection of it all. But you're helping me because I have very dusty file boxes in my brain and you're blowing the dust off.
I mean, I try. You know, it's a lot easier when you're an art historian to be able to talk to somebody who's there a lot and get like, you know, all the info you want.
Yeah, yeah.
Rather than be like, let me go piece this together and come up with my own version, I suppose. Gosh, let's see. The next one is a really obscure one from Mondo, which was Wind River.
Yeah, yeah, that was a strange one. Just in terms of how well that poster was received as well. Like, and I don't mean to sound like I'm boasting. I'm not. I just mean like it was very surprising that so many people gravitated towards that poster because you know. I know Sicario, which I still haven't even seen. Was it Sicario, that director's first film?
Mm-hmm.
And that had received a lot of praise, and I hadn't even seen it, but guys were like, hey, do you want to do Wind River? And I was like, okay, well, let me check it out. And I got the concept right from the trailer. Same thing. I just saw this beautiful, like, aerial shot of that deep black sky with the rolling white sort of hills, and then the young woman running into... you know, into the woods, I guess. And I had read the brief synopsis and it spoke about young woman going missing, and that it's assumed that there are men in the town responsible for it.
I'm Jane Banner.
And you know, and I just kind of put two and two together. I put the story together from watching the trailer. I did watch the film as well, but came right from the trailer. And I just, you know, envisioned like, well, she's like this wounded deer that's heading for these hills, but she doesn't know that what she's running from, she's running right into, you know, essentially. And then having the wolf make up the mountains itself, the formation of the wolf. Again, it just came right away, and that's why I go with those kind of ideas, the ones from the jump, because if it hits you right away, it's like intuition, you know, it's like that's your gut feeling off the bat. That's probably the best one.
Why would a teenage girl be out here? What's she running from?
You're looking for clues, but you're missing all the signs.
Shouldn't we wait for backup?
This isn't the land of backup, Jane. This is a land of you're on your own.
Oh my God. You won't get the answers you're looking for, no matter what you find. Why would your daughter run from home?
I don't know why. You didn't tell me. Out here, you cannot blink. Not ever.
This place, what it takes from us, what it took from you.
I got lucky.
Luck lives in the city.
Get your hand off that weapon!
It was really well received, and the guys and the folks at Mondo loved it. So, yeah,
I don't know if you've seen it, Night of the Hunter.
I know the movie with what's the actor's name? You probably know. I can't.
It's not going to come to
John,
me.
John Grisham. Grisham.
Is it Grisham?
Is that the same Grisham? John Grisham.
No, that's not it.
You're talking about the film noir movie, Night of the Hunter, right?
The one where the guy is the priest and he's got love and hate on his knuckles.
Yeah, yeah. Something Grisham. I'm Googling this right now.
All
right. Night of the Hunter.
I can't remember.
It is Robert Mitchum.
Mitchum.
Robert Mitchum. Okay.
Yeah, John Grisham's like a thriller writer.
Yeah. I knew it was something Mitchum. Anyways,
it has an M to it.
But I know what you mean. Yeah, it has that feeling to it for sure.
Yeah, that sort of like fairy tale kind of, but like elevated adult kind of situation.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's kind of what I always reminded
about. Fantastic.
Well, I meant from your poster.
Oh, sorry. Oh, thanks.
You're just not good at compliments.
No, I'm and I... No, and I appreciate it. I think I'm so maybe unfamiliar. I don't know.
No worries.
No, I don't mean.
I'm used to abuse, not compliments.
Yeah, exactly.
I read all the forums.
Yeah. Thank you though. That's very kind of you to say.
We've mentioned it before, but might as well get into it now, which is not a pun. Society for Mad Duck.
Oh yeah. Yes. That was an interesting one.
This was your first with Mad Duck, right?
Yes. It was either this or Blue Velvet. I can't remember which came first.
I think it
might have been that one. I think it was that one.
I think it's that one.
Yeah. Here I am asking you, like, which one was it? When was it?
According to my notes, it's this one.
But that was a fun one to do. I had never seen, or no, had I? I had just seen Society. I think that's what it was. I don't remember where I watched it or why, but it had come up, and I'd watched it. And then, like a week later, I think they emailed me, "Hey, do you have any interest in Society?" And I was like, "Okay, well, that seems like a sign that I got to do it." And that one was a little bit different, though, because normally I see. Well, no, it's different in a lot of ways in terms of the art, but I mean in my approach. Like I say to you, normally I kind of. I go with what comes to me off the jump, but with that poster, that actually took some like sort of deep diving into the film and maybe the meanings behind things and what this, that, and the other thing. But what I actually found with that, I think I was watching it might have been a sort of a film school or a college, like like a, what's the word I'm looking for here?
Everyone's
gathered in an auditorium. It was like a speaking engagement with Brian Yuzna.
An assembly?
Wasn't an assembly.
Oh, no, he's running for class president.
No, it wasn't class president. it was
in society?
No. I'm talking about in real life.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. In society, life, he runs for class president.
And... Yes. No. I'm talking about Brian Yuzna, the director. He was doing the word's escaping me. He's speaking at a film school. He's just speaking, talking about directing. And he talks about...
A master class kind of thing.
Yeah, I guess. Like more like at a like film school, in an auditorium, just talking about what he does. But anyways, he had expressed basically that he was a big fan of Salvador Dali.
Okay.
And that Salvador Dali was a very big inspiration behind a lot of his use of effects in a lot of his movies. And I was like, well, that's really interesting. And obviously for most people, if they're familiar with Dali, they know that Involuntis Mors is like probably one of his most iconic, if not his most iconic piece he's ever done. And so I was like, oh, that seems pretty fitting. Like these people sort of like, you know, that are essentially entangled with one another. But, you know, obviously in Dali's version, it's a photo and it's people just sort of stacked on top of each other. He actually built, I know that Dali, he built like a platform that allowed them to sort of be perched on there like that. But I was like, well, what if I took that and I actually made them melting into each other rather than like, you know, linking arms and being hidden and like body parts coming out of places where they shouldn't. And I was like, that's kind of cool, but it still feels a little bit too dark. It feels a little bit too serious. And I was like, how do I make it 80s? Oh, throw a pair of Clubmasters on it. Like, you know, a pair of Ray-Bans on the skull face. And that'll be the little, with the Beverly Hills reflection in it, you know, that high society sort of, you know, vibe to it or whatever, California in the 80s. And I was like, there's the humor. You know, I brought the humor into it. And also a little in that actor, I think his name's Eric something. Could be wrong, but his expression is that sort of like a Joey Lawrence, like, whoa, you know, kind of look on his face. So that kind of brought that ridiculous quirkiness of that film into it. But yeah, that was a fun one. But that idea had to come to me from kind of doing some research, which still does happen. I don't always go with my gut, but I like to go with my gut too.
I mean, it is very evocative, you know, because I grew up in a beach town in the 80s and like, yeah, the first glance of it, just especially with the different variants that were done.
Yeah,
you know, the I think the one with the blue and the yellow and the glasses. Mm-hmm. It really does feel like an 80s like sunscreen ad or something. Yeah. If you glance at it too sunscreen quickly, ad.
That's good. That's a good. Yeah, that's funny.
Because it's just like, and then you look at it longer, you're like, yes, I know what this is.
Yeah, and I mean, I was trying to get away with two, like, there's two, clearly two, you know, butts on it, but I really tried to avoid showing any nudity. I wanted it to be something again. Because well, if you're going to because
you tackled that scene, right? And that scene is lots of very non-sexy nudity.
Yes, exactly. You know, but I still wanted it to be, you know, able to be hung up if someone wanted to have it in their home and have it be. I mean, it's definitely not as tasteful as Voluptuous Mors, you know what I mean? But it's at the same time.
How do you make the shunting scene in society tasteful?
The way I did it. I think that's the closest you can get.
Yeah, I mean, you went with that scene.
Yeah.
But I mean, I don't know what else you do with that movie, if you want to convey the horror. I mean,
I think there was an artist. Oh, God, what's his name?
Because the original is like she's pulling off her face.
The original poster is horrendous. It's awful.
Yeah, it looks nothing like what goes on in the movie.
No, and it doesn't tell you anything, which is sometimes can be a good thing, but it was poorly executed. Like, I honestly think if you'd never seen Society and you looked at my poster, you also wouldn't have any idea. But
I'd have a better idea than the original one sheet.
Pardon?
I'd have a much better idea than I would from the original.
Yeah, perhaps. You'd be somewhat prepared, maybe.
Well, because the original looks like it's like a James Bond film that the woman pulls her face off.
Yeah.
He's like in a white tuxedo dinner jacket. And
I think there was one piece of art that I had seen for Society that was, I think it was must have been for a Blu-ray cover or something like that. And it was a big American flag. And then it had the American flag backdrop. And then it had a man in a suit with like a snifter of like whiskey or something. But it was, his head was like the middle finger, I think, the giant middle finger.
Oh, yeah.
Thumbs up or something, the giant hand. And yeah, it was kind of showing like, it was showing that high society type of like, it definitely conveyed the idea of like superiority of an asshole type of like, you know, and culture and whatever, blah, 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 you know, and it conveyed that vibe, but I obviously wanted to go more of like horror rather than go the politics aspect of it. And,
you know, I think
he's social a commentary. Pardon?
I think you succeeded.
Well, thanks.
Oh man, it's funny whenever whenever I come across that one, because I don't know why I stumble across it more frequently than you would think. Mm-hmm. I think about you more than you would think, because I come across that poster quite a lot.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. It's an interesting one.
The next one, you did another major property for Mondo. You did the 1940s Wolfman for the their second Universal horror show.
Mm-hmm.
Did you get to pick that? Did they assign it to you?
I think I picked it. Okay. I think I heard that the show was coming up, and I was like, I wonder if there's anything I could tap into with that. And then I was watching Wolfman just on a whim, I think. And I had the concept of the hand overlapping the other hand.
Mm-hmm.
And doing even right down to doing it, that scale, which was 18 by 36. So a long sort of skinny, almost, gig style poster. And I think originally too, I had the idea of making that a sort of, I don't know what is the next up after triptych, but like doing essentially
tetratic
yeah. before.
Yeah. It's very annoying to say.
it doesn't match. And I feel like it should be like quatric or something, but anyways, but of doing all of the monsters right in that sort of same form. So you had nice, you know, the framework would still kind of hold. I still have a couple ideas brewing in my head, but I don't think it'll ever happen now. But yeah, that was one where I just wanted to go really, I wanted to make something really classy, for lack of a better term, very prestigious feeling. And just like, oh, that's very nice. And it's not overbound with, you know, or overdone with the horror aspect necessarily, or the campy aspect, maybe, you know.
The tetratech thing comes from the tetramorph, which is the four gospels as they turn into their animal forms.
Oh.
In case you're wondering.
You really, I'll write that one down so I don't forget.
Yeah. In case you're curious, Matthew turns into a man, so you're fine. But yeah, so that's where that comes from.
That's interesting, though. It is
your very pedantic footnote for the interview here. Yeah, so you have the say what?
I just said pedantic. I'm just writing down all these large words.
It's funny. I in student evaluations, every once in a while, I'll get the word pedantic, and I'm like, what am I supposed to be? I'm a professor of art history. If I'm not pedantic, am I doing it right? Yeah, so you have the iconic cane, which I feel like it got lost in, like, I don't know, in the idea of the original Wolfman, right? Because it's chunky, for lack of a better word.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the newer one with Anthony Hopkins and Benicio del Toro, right? They make it much more, almost dark shadows kind of wolf cane. But the original is a solid piece of silver that...
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
like a club, you're pretty hard.
Yeah, I love the look of the cane, so I just really wanted to illustrate it, I think, more or less. And I wanted to figure out a way to work in like metallic inks or metallic papers into which we did. We used metallic inks for that poster. But yeah, it was just an iconic piece, you know, prop from the film, and I hadn't seen it used very, very frequently in things, mm-hmm. you know, and in existing art, so. I know I feel like I'm giving you the same answer all the time in terms of just trying to avoid what's been done. But I think every artist obviously tries to do that. I think it's just, you know. But yeah, that was, it's a fairly self-explanatory concept, you know. but I just wanted to go very minimalist and simple with a very minimalist and sort of simple story that everybody knows, you know, and we're all familiar with, and just pay tribute to it in a very minimalist way. That's really.
And you avoided doing a face again.
Yeah. Well, I mean, again, like, and there have been countless posters done for the Wolfman that show his face, and they've been executed beautifully. So it's like, if I think that, you know, I'm just going to go a different route, you know, actually, speaking about Jonathan Burton, he just did a Wolfman poster recently. That's incredible. Incredible. And have you seen it?
Yes.
Have you seen his poster?
Yes.
For Wolfman? Yeah. It's again, a brilliant take on it. There's no wolf.
No, it's like they're walking away from the window.
Yeah. It's beautiful. It's brilliant. And that's, and again, I like that. It's like you're able to tell this story without being so obvious about it. And I think that's a really cool thing to do. And Jonathan's great. Remember,
he did like a Fargo poster, I think, that was similar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think he did two Fargo posters, if I'm not mistaken.
Sometimes it's harder for me to keep them all straight.
Yeah,
who did what?
Yeah, I have his Rosemary's Baby poster.
I have that one too, and I have it with my name spelled out in the tiles.
Oh, that's awesome! That's wicked. Yeah, that's one of my favorite posters I own. That hung up in my dining room for years.
I have that one. I have his rear window.
Yeah.
And I have his King Kong.
Oh, that's all great pieces. All great pieces. He's a sweet, sweet dude. Very nice.
Yeah, I mean, his stuff, I mean, all of you guys, like, it's sometimes hard to grab them, yeah. You know, because particularly if you want one, probably a million other people want them too.
Yeah.
So it can be a challenge sometimes. Your next thing you did is interesting because you've got both versions. You've got the 90s miniseries of It that was done for Waxwork. For a gatefold, and then you've got the Mondo It, which is a poster that was also a Warner Brothers piece. Mm-hmm. I want to start with the Waxwork because they reissued it. It was so popular. That must have been flattering.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, a lot of work went into that packaging. That's probably the most extensive packaging I've ever worked on, I think, in terms of how long it took. And I mean, it's a three-time gatefold. So mm-hmm. just like it opens three times. You know what I mean? So it's very, very large package. I have one of them here, I think. I don't know if you've seen it in person.
I own it.
You own it, so there you go. But yeah, it's it's very you've seen it. It's very extensive. So it's nice when people appreciate it too, but also that it got a second release, the more people get to own it, because that's the important thing about vinyl, is it's tangible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, getting to hold it and look at the artwork while you listen to it, you know.
That's actually how I got into all this. I collected the vinyl first.
Oh, really?
Then I started getting into the posters.
That's awesome. I've heard it that way and the reverse of that as well.
Mm-hmm. No, I remember when it was just Death Waltz.
Yeah. No, I have a couple of Death Waltz when it was just Death Waltz too. I have the They Live and Let the Right One In that they initially released.
And I remember, I mean, Waxwork, when they started, I think one of their first ones was Hannibal.
Mm-hmm. I think Reanimator was their very first one.
Yes.
And Gary did that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then Mondo was The Omen, I think, was one of their very early ones that they did out of Waxwork.
Maniac, I believe.
Was it Maniac?
The Elijah Wood version, mm-hmm. I believe. I think, yes.
Okay.
But yeah, excuse me.
No worries. So you like the idea though of the Pennywise figure through the balloon?
Well, that was that was done first. That Waxwork was done first. I mean, originally I had a lot of plans to do a really sort of interactive pop up book.
Yeah, because there's a lot of inserts in the piece.
Yeah. Well, originally I think the concept. A little bit of inside baseball, the gatefold was completely different. I was actually going to do an interior of the sewer looking out, and I can't remember exactly now what it was, but you could move the sleeve in and out of the slip case, and the image would change, like of Pennywise's perspective looking out through the grate. And then originally too, when you got to, it was going to be a center. It was originally just going to be a single gatefold. And when it opened up, the Pennywise actually jumped out. Like it was going to be a pop-up, like okay. a pop-up book straight up. But once we got to doing the, we ended up finding out, oh, it's going to be three LPs. So everything kind of had to change because there's so much music, you know, that kind of got kiboshed. But and so I think the actual balloon illustration was, I think it was like a, not, I don't want to say last resort, but it was definitely like not the original, like not my first choice. I can't remember what the other ones were, to be honest. We worked on that project for so long. But I think it still turned out fairly well.
Yeah, so I mean, it sold out really fast, the first edition of it.
Yeah. No, that was,
which,
that,
I mean,
was
that, I mean, great. I say that, people think of Mondo, of course, selling out in seconds, but like Waxworks editions are usually much larger and do not sell out like within a day.
I also think though too, that like, I mean, I don't exactly take any credit for that whatsoever. I think that it's the fact that soundtrack is so nostalgic for a lot of people, and that it's never been released before ever on vinyl. So people would have bought it regardless.
I bought it for the art.
Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate that. No, I think it's super fun artwork though. We did get to do some fun stuff with it though. Like we did gloss overlays on the actual photos on the insert, so they felt a little separate from the piece. I mean, I would have loved to actually have little photos you could pop in, you know, like let's go as big as we can.
I think they are headed that way. I think they're trying to be, a little bit more or different. I think they're definitely looking for different things.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what originally inspired me to go different with that artwork was their Phantom City had done their The Thing soundtrack. The first edition came with the ice variant or something, and I think
separates. Yeah.
And I was like, if we can do that, we can do anything. I was like, so let's get crazy with it, you know? Let's have fun with this artwork. And it's. So you can literally, there's no rules. There's no rules to hit that character or anything. It's like, so let's just, you know, throw caution on the wind. But we did I think it turned out good for what we got. So
now you're it for Mondo and Warner Brothers. It does have a little bit of a Jonathan Burton feel to it.
I think so.
Something like the palette is a little bit
softer, maybe.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't mean that as an insult, obviously.
I would take that as a hard compliment.
It's radically different than your Waxwork design.
Yeah, well, I think it's also like a year apart. Again, that's how much changes, right? When you start cranking out so much work and working on these different projects, is you're essentially just, you know, you're always learning, you're always figuring new techniques and things that you like doing better. And that was like a drastic change of one style from the other, one style to the other, in terms of what I see, at least. Maybe not to people who aren't me wouldn't notice, but I would. But that was a bit of a disheartening situation with that poster, actually.
Another heartbreaker.
Yeah. Only because it was supposed to be released on a wider scale, and and it wasn't, to no fault of anybody, really. It was just like, I think the hype surrounding that film, there was so much going on that things must have got lost in the shuffle or things got skewed. But it essentially was only shared on Facebook or something. I think that was the extent that people saw it. It was one share or whatever. But yeah, it was actually filmed in Port Hope, which is about an hour from where I live. That whole movie was filmed in both films were filmed in Ontario. And I had actually some friends send me photos of Port Hope so I could have like correct reference photos. I couldn't get all the way an hour and a half out there. Like I didn't even have a car at the time. So just to get like all the details of the buildings right and make sure everything was perfect. And again, I wasn't allowed to see the film either. That film was kept so under wraps that they're like, here's the trailer. That's all you got. And so I couldn't really tap into any of the more deeper rooted aspects of the story. I could literally work with what was surface level and what was given to everybody else. That's why that composition's a little bit on the nose as well. But thankfully this was at the beginning. This was before the It art blast that happened following that film, because now it's everywhere. It's everywhere.
I gotta tell you, I mean, I did not care for it.
I liked it. I liked the first one. I did.
Yeah, the second one's really the one I'm talking about.
The second one, I don't even remember it. Really.
The CGI disaster from hell.
Just less is more, man. Less is more always. Just, yeah. You know, I don't need his face going wow, 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 and doing all this like After Effects stuff. Just the clown's scary. Let the clown be scary.
Yeah, and I mean, he did such a good job with the performance. Skarsgård did.
Those one-on-one moments of him with Georgie in the first one, and then in the bleachers in the second one, it proves you don't need to be, you know, animating him any further. Like, he's, the character itself is unsettling enough. It works, you know. Don't, if it ain't broke, you know. But with that poster though, again, it was very surface level. I guess I took what I knew of the story because I've read the book, I own the book. And just tried to apply it in terms of like Derry, Maine as a bubble, essentially this bubble that seems like, you know, it's completely separated from the rest of the world, you know, but the bubble is under the guise of like, it's governed by Pennywise. Like, he controls everything that goes within it, the parents, the kids, the everything, you know? And so I tried to throw some sort of conceptual aspect to the poster. But it also had to kind of work as key art as well. Yeah. So sometimes with key art, you can't get too crazy with it. They you know, they wanted to sell the movie, not intrigue art lovers all the time. You know what I mean? So
now, which one do you prefer? Do you prefer the 90s or do you prefer the contemporary one?
I don't know. I don't know, because like...
Are you just being political now?
Political how?
You don't want like your Instagram feed to be flooded by... He said he liked Tim Curry more than...
No, I don't care about any of that, because I'm the guy who tends to disagree with everybody. You know, I'm the people who I'm the person who that people can often think is being contrarian, but I'm just being honest. Like, sure. And I honestly think, like, and I grew up with the original It series. I had the three thing VHS box set and all that. But I think in the end, like, I think Bill Skarsgård did a better job of capturing what Pennywise felt like in the book. I felt like the new film captured the book a lot more than the TV series. The TV series is poorly made, but it's got nostalgia value. Like, Tim Curry's fantastic, and he'll always be considered, like, you know, one of the greatest actors of all time. But, like, I don't know, maybe they're both even. I think they're just both even. They're two completely different things.
They're incredibly different films.
But I feel the same way about both of them. I enjoy them, and that's, yeah, we'll leave it at that.
Thank you for joining us at Nights of Horror. Tune in next time for the conclusion of Matt Ryan Tobin.